Good morning and welcome to this morning's first session of, post-keynote session of LinuxConf AU 2017. Our first presentation today will be from Audrey Lobo-Pulo, and she'll be discussing publicly releasing government models. Please make her welcome.
Hi everyone, I'm Audrey, and it is absolutely amazing to be here today. LCA is where my personal journey on this topic began 2 years ago, and I am just so honored to be able to share it with you today, my community. But before I begin, I just want to say that this presentation is based on my own personal experiences and my own personal views, and are not necessarily those of any government. My intention is to provide a backdrop for discussions on how the open source philosophy will further contribute to society. But this time, in a new arena, public policy. So let's take Douglas Adams's cue from The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy and travel to a fictitious world. Let's explore the possibilities by dreaming forwards. So how many people here have voted in a national election? Sorry, wrong crowd, compulsory voting. And did you really understand the quantitative impacts of the policies that you were voting for? And of course, this isn't really easy because we live in a really complex society where the rules are actually not that easy to understand. So how many people in this room play computer games or have ever played a computer game? Sorry, wrong crowd again. And how well, you know, did you know your terrain, your limitations, what you can and can't do, how to optimize your score and your well-being? So I'm not trying to trivialize our reality by comparing it to a virtual world, but there are some insights which might provide glimpses into the future, into how we will interact with our policy environment in, say, 10 years' time. In a world where perhaps we could control our destiny a lot more than we do today. So imagine an app that allows you to test drive policy so that you can determine the future that you want to live in. See, tacit knowledge can be a wonderful thing. You may not necessarily understand why you are making certain decisions, but you could learn what the best decisions for you actually are. Soon you'd have a deeper knowledge and understanding of your policy environment, what the key drivers are, and what to expect. And before long, you'd be navigating the waters of public debate like a pro. In a world where open data is becoming prolific, where the Internet of Things will soon become commonplace and where big data is becoming the norm, perhaps open policy modeling may not be unfathomable. So last week, I was watching a talk by Kevin Kelly. He's a digital visionary, and he used an analogy that I just absolutely love. The context was he was talking about gravity. He said, imagine raindrops falling into a valley. The actual path of a raindrop as it goes down the valley is unpredictable. We cannot see where it's going, but the general direction is very inevitable. It's downwards. He said, technological systems have leanings, urgencies, and tendencies. So we may not know how we will get to our destination, but some of our destinations are inevitable. I think that policy modeling is also leaning towards an inevitability, and that is the concept of open policy design using analytics. But before I try to convince you why, let's take a brief detour to the history of policy modeling. So, policy options are proposed for a whole bunch of reasons and are usually based on political philosophies. But we live in a quantitative world, and for policies to be put into place, Governments need to make decisions on their policy implementations, answering questions around who, what policies, and how much. Now, these sorts of judgments generally made by politicians and bureaucrats together. Then came the digital age, and personal computers revolutionized policy analytics. With increased computational power, the dynamics between politicians and bureaucrats changed too. Policies were quantified more quickly, and the interactions became more efficient and iterative. Computational power afforded new efficiencies, and these new increased efficiencies resulted in more demand, more estimates with a quicker turnaround. And you could argue that this created a smorgasbord of policy options which would inevitably benefit the public. But today, we are at the next juncture, the digital disruption. My proposition is that open policy design using analytics will soon become the way of the future. Why? Because this new computational generation is not just more faster and more powerful, it is so much more. It's smarter, more agile, and much more immersive than ever before. So what does this actually mean for contemporary policy and analytics? Well, user interface design is just so much more sophisticated. We can engage with services and information without technology getting in the way. Almost seamless interactions. Brilliant communicative tools through data visualizations, which help us understand our information a whole lot better. Then there's cloud computing, which has taken processing to the next level, moving from personal computers to cloud providers. Cheaper services, high performance, scalability, improved availability, accessibility. The levels of computational flexibility we can afford today are unprecedented. And finally, big data. And I'm using this term very loosely to cover all sorts of data. Real-time data, private data, metadata. If you believe the hype, the amount of data we will collect over the next 5 years will be simply phenomenal. And the issues around them, data ethics, data privacy, accessibility, data guardianship, are becoming more important than ever. Data is the new commodity. Why? Because it gives us valuable insights into how we interact in our society. And these interactions underpin our economy. So data is incredibly valuable, and there are many data custodians gathering valuable information. So all these three factors together, I think, will tug at policy modeling and pull it towards an open policy design model. Inevitability. Now, with this new concept comes a new set of dynamics between governments, stakeholders, and the public. Or does it? But more on that a little later. Now, developers love looking at code, so let's get back to the basics. What is a government policy model, anyway? Put simply, it's an implementation of code to create a virtual society, a model of our public policy system. And the main reason for creating government policy models is to test out different policies and to analyze their outcomes. Really, really incredibly important for decision making. So you might be wondering, okay, how do I go into that black box? What does it actually look like on the inside? And this is the best representation that I can come up with. So your government modeling system, I'll call it a system because it comprises of many, many bits. You have your data, which in most cases could come from a variety of sources like your open data, your administration data, census data, survey data, real-time data, but all that data sort of feeds into your actual model. And what you get out of that is the output. So things like how much you expect things to cost, what the forecast of something could be down the track. And this gives us valuable information, right? So if you look at each of those three components, you look at the data component. And open data has been particularly successful in showing what the current status is of current policy. And we've seen huge amounts of success with GovHack in showing incredible insights into data that is open that we did not actually know about. So that's been really successful. But you also can look at the output of a model and use it and compare it to reality and assess the state of that model. It gives you information about how accurate that model is. And you could use that information to sort of fine-tune your model, hence that little information and analysis feedback loop. Now, the output can be interpreted in a variety of ways. We could look at it on a geographic platform, or we could look at it by gender, by age groups. There's many ways to look at the output of your model, and it tells you something about the policy system that you are trying to model. And this is the stuff that is highly contested. But are we actually debating enough about what those numbers mean and what the implications of those numbers are, what the sensitivity of those numbers are? But again, before we go into that further, let's actually drill down even deeper and look at the different components of the models themselves. So I like to think about a government policy model as having four main components. The first being software development. And this sort of covers things like the algorithms used in forecasting. And recently we've had a resurgence of machine learning, deep learning tools. Software development could also cover aspects of the data processing of the actual model. We have your economic assumptions. And some examples of these could be what the World Bank thinks is going to happen to the global GDP or your unemployment rates. So these are the economic assumptions that can be used by the model. And then there's your behavioral economics, which is some kind of way of representing our interactions, how rational they are, whether they're based on social decisions or psychological reasons or cognitive factors. So really, really complicated ways of representing how people make the decisions they do. And finally, there's the policy implementation, which to a bunch of developers is simply translating the policy environment into code. So what we have are four components that together describe a policy environment in a virtual world. So we've just looked at the components of a government policy model. Now here's the thing. In a fictitious world, what if government policy models were freely available, just like open source software is? Government open source models, which I affectionately call GOSMs, so I will use that phrase as we go down through the presentation, refer to the idea that government-developed models whose purpose is to design and evaluate policy are freely available to everyone to use, distribute, and modify. Just imagine the possibilities. And this is something that countries around the world are starting to think about as we move towards a more open government world. Firstly, we'd be allowing citizens to participate and collaborate in government decision-making in a whole new way. And for policymakers, the open sourcing of policy modeling would mean opening the doors to new ideas and innovative solutions. And I can't emphasize enough the importance of multidisciplinary skills. My personal story is that I started with a physics background. I moved into policy, then looked at economics, dabbled in a bit of data science, working with stakeholders, and now speaking about publicly releasing models. And I think that as we go into the future, having those disciplinary skills will be pretty important. I say this because I think that the most amount of gains that we still haven't uncovered yet will be in the tech area. And I think that's incredibly empowering. So where would you expect the most gains to be had? My guess, and I kind of hinted at that just now, and that is software development. The recent surge of new and emerging technologies, along with the evolution of contemporary analytics, aka data science, the resurgence of artificial intelligence, etc., suggests that there is much scope for new solutions in this space. Who knows? IBM's Watson may have a suggestion or two on some really interesting policy proposals. Technology is a great enabler. The existence of GitHub in itself means that, in theory, you could fork out your own policy model. And any open source developer knows that by sharing code, you can make it better and more reliable. Wouldn't it be awesome if we could translate these improvements or efficiencies into policy design? Now, before we begin thinking about the possibilities around the public release of government models, I want to draw your attention to a few exceptions. And these are loosely based on the US federal source code policy. And the exceptions are sharing of the code is restricted by law or regulation, where sharing of the code could create an identifiable risk to national security, confidential information, or compromise privacy protection. If releasing the code could create an identifiable risk to government objectives, such as government's compliance activities, for example. If the government believes that it is not in the national interest. So these are kind of like a very broad set of exceptions to publicly releasing government models. So we've gone through a few reasons why it may not be in the public's interest to release government policy models, and these are fairly important. But what of the models we can release? How would government think about the public release of models? Has open data paved the way for thinking about open models? I find it useful to start thinking about the principles behind the public release of government models. What might they be? And this is important so that countries can begin releasing their models in a way that's widely adopted and consistent. So this is kind of what I came up with. You'll find that almost all of these are based on the open source philosophy. If you guys can think of any others or come up with any patches, please do let me know. So I guess I'll walk through them and describe them as we go along. The first one being that models are released by default wherever possible. The open by default principle allows for maximum public engagement within the community. Another huge advantage, it contributes to public trust, which means improved public satisfaction. Number two, we engage with the community in a spirit of collaboration. I guess this takes the idea of the public release of models one step further. So we actually engage with the community as early as possible, maybe even during the model development process itself. So in this one, I'm kind of reaching for the utopia of open policy design in a whole new way. Number three, that government release a minimum viable product model. a product where the basic requirements of the model have been met. So I guess there's a bit of a balance between two and three. So you want to engage your community early enough during the development process, but you still want to release a minimum viable product where people have expectations of what the model is supposed to produce. So you kind of set out the skeletal framework. Now, government may choose to add further complexity to this down the track, or perhaps some developer in the community may create something really innovative. Number four, easily discoverable. This one kind of speaks for itself. You don't want your potential contributors searching around for your models. We have data.gov, but I think now it's time for models.gov. The US has code.gov for their own government's custom developed software. Number five, clearly outlined uses and licensing. And this is critically important. This is where the policy analyst's expertise really comes into play. When building a policy model, one needs to be aware of the intent of the model, what the model's limitations are, not just the model's limitations, but what the data limitations are, why we're building this model, under what conditions the output of the model is actually meaningful. And in a sense, the interpretation is really important because it tells you about the quality of your output. So in some ways, this is sort of outlining what the quality of these models could potentially be. And with licensing, every software developer is only too aware of what can potentially be done with code that's released, but more on that a bit later too. And lastly, maximum possible access provided. So this kind of refers to software used in creating policy models. And obviously, free and open source is widely accessible. So it would be more conducive to people contributing back. Could also refer to accessibility via the internet or hardware, the technological infrastructure, whether or not API access has been provided. Dan Callahan's brilliant quote from his keynote the other day, "Free licenses don't further my freedom if I can't run the software." So GOSMs would level the playing field for everyone. Politicians, the media, lobby groups, stakeholders, and the general public. But whose code is it, anyway? Being a public good, GOSMs are notionally funded by the taxpayer and attributed to the state. Now, for those who aren't familiar with what a public good is, a public good is something that's non-rival, which means your usage of something doesn't prevent anyone else from using it, and non-excludable, which means that you can't actually exclude anyone from using something that's been released. So what are the implications of publicly releasing government policy models from a private entity's perspective? Now, I don't have the answers, but I'm just putting these questions out there because I think it's important to start a discussion. Would it be ethically appropriate for private entities to gain from GOSMs without passing on the benefits to society? Which brings us to the question of licensing. The open source community has used the copyleft license to ensure that any derivative works under this license remains open to everyone. So how do we determine which open source license is best suited? For simplicity and incompleteness, I've just put up three of the main open source licenses on the table. And in a nutshell, we have the MIT license, simple and permissive, the Apache license, I'm concerned about patents. And without wanting to reopen the debate of GPL version 3 versus GPL version 2, we also have the GPL license. I care about sharing improvements. because I just can't resist, let me just put it out there that perhaps locking down models on government servers provided by private vendors may not be conducive to a public release. But please do not ask any questions about GPL version 3 versus GPL version 2. Or if you do, please do not phrase it like a question. Which brings us back to our original question, which is, which license? So the New Zealand government has done some awesome work around looking at the appropriate licensing of government code. And I encourage you to check out the documents. New Zealand Gold Software Extension, if anyone's interested, you could have a look at that. And so New Zealand recently ran a public consultation process last year to try and sort of figure out what sorts of licenses would be required for what types of situations. So what we have here, and you may not be able to read the tiny fonts, is a decision tree that steps government officials through determining an appropriate license. And I think this is absolutely brilliant, right? I just couldn't resist, so I'm going to read you a couple of these, probably because you can't see it, but just to give you a sense of the sorts of language and the sorts of questions that they consider. Are there any exceptions in the review and release process that cannot be addressed by amendment or anonymization before licensing the source code? Would you like everyone to be able to reuse other people's distributed adaptations of the source code in future? Yes? No? So a really comprehensive decision tree. But what about government policy models? Ultimately, the licensing of software governs how you can distribute the code and the rules around that. GOSMs, though, are unique in that they are mainly a tool for designing public policy, and they don't really require redistribution for private gains. With traditional software, the product of value is the code itself, which requires redistribution for maximum benefit. But what if the redistribution of code is incidental to the main product? What if stakeholders are able to use GOSMs in a way to maximize their own profits without needing to redistribute the code at all? Would they then hold the balance of power in public debate? Is that a world we would like to see? And besides, what would they have that open models could really benefit from? Data. Precious private data. And it is important that privacy is protected. But in theory, stakeholders and private companies could use government-developed policy models with their own private data to gain new insights into navigating our policy environment for private benefit. So I guess I'm not trying to make a judgment, but I want to raise the awareness of the issue because I think it's important that government and society consider the questions. But the next question is, and here's the trick. How valuable is the model without the data anyway? And do private organizations already have their own models? Almost certainly. Public policy is just that, public. And the rules, legislations, etc., governing society are indeed open. So why the fuss around licensing? I don't know. I guess it's all in the details. It depends which model, who your stakeholders and the players are. Why shouldn't we protect the taxpayer-funded model? Perhaps the ideal GOSM license is a mythical creature. And at the end of the day, there's little point in releasing code that really isn't used. Communities are critically important for the long-term success of open source projects, and GOSMs would be no different. Having a license that is well established reduces the barrier to entry for most software developers. Why? Because you know what to expect. You don't need to get legal advice around what you can and can't do with the software. My personal view is that a copyleft license may not be the best for government code that could potentially improve service provision in society. Yes, maybe having privately funded apps that make services in the transport, health, and education sector more efficient could be a good thing. You're drawing in startups, etc. But I do believe that policy design is fundamentally different. Ultimately, government is the one with the authority to implement policy. And it's possible that stakeholders may choose to share their models in their negotiations. Perhaps the dynamics between government, stakeholders, lobby groups, and citizens will still be much the same. But increased transparency can only be a good thing. And the additional benefits would bring new efficiencies and solutions, as we've seen. Let's keep on dreaming forwards a little more. Imagine an open model platform where you can plug in different data sets into different models and see what you end up with. Perhaps you may have access to just a limited number of private data sets along with open data. Maybe this depends on your level of access or permissions. Maybe you have access to privately held models and can choose to share your own privately developed models with certain parties. Perhaps we will enter a world where parties trade data and models, keeping ethics and privacy protection firmly in the front of our minds. Just think of the potential, though. Passion, collaboration, and transparency are woven into our open source culture, and these are key in supporting our democracy. Pia gave me this great quote that I was able to use today, so thank you, Pia. Democracy without openness leads us away from democracy. Every community has room to grow, but the open source community has taught the world that empowering individuals can bring about progress in epic proportions. So to conclude, in an open government utopia, open public policy development will be a collaborative effort between government and citizens, where knowledge, data, and analytics is freely available to everyone. Thank you.
And thank you very much, Audrey. Does anyone have any questions?
Before that, I just want to dedicate this presentation to my son. Couldn't be here.
So yes, if there are any questions, and please phrase them in the form of a question or I will cut you off.
Unless they're GPL version 2 versus version 3.
If they're about the GPL, then do I cut them off if it's about GPL V2?
Thanks, I have a list, but I'll stick to one. There was a phrase during the debate on Brexit, we're tired of experts. We're tired of something that seems to be objective arguments, objective evidence that leads towards a policy conclusion. I think for most of us here, I'll leave that out. So the question is, how can we persuade people there's some potential there when they're intrinsically resisting that?
That's an excellent question, Paul. Thank you for that. My opinion is that there is technical, there's complex and there's complicated. I think that, you know, our technical world can be complicated, but it's okay for it to be complex, and it's about translating that interpretation to the general public. Now, we've seen data visualization really take this to the next level, where people don't really understand what's happening in the background, but you put a really interesting data visualization in front of them, and it tells you a story. And I think our big challenge in tech is not just getting the technical work done, but being able to communicate that in a really effective way where it becomes second nature to the public, where technology doesn't get in the way. And I think that's the challenge that we need to address. So it's not about not making things technical, it's about leaving the complicatedness, but translating the complexity in a way that's easier to understand.
So we all understand that garbage in gives garbage out no matter how good the model is. So the critical thing from my perspective is the data that goes into our wonderful model. So my question is, can you have this unless without the data that's used for the decision making being open?
Sorry, the last part of your question, can we...
Can we have this, government open models that are useful without the data that goes into it being open?
Another excellent question. My view is that your output is only really as good as the model and the data coming in. I would like to think that over the next 5 years, the quality of the data that we will be collecting will be a lot better. And I'd also like to think that the models that we create moving into a data science world will be a lot better too. So in any case, I think transparency can only be a good thing, because if you release that, you can actually see for yourself the quality of the data and compare that to the quality of your output.
Hi, Audrey. Your kind of first step on that was that models should be open by default. But there are a whole list of exceptions, and governments tend to be good at declaring that this falls within an exception. Should there be maybe a 1B that says where they decline, or is there a way of solving that by having some requirement to disclose the reasons for which they decided that they fell under the various provisions? And is there a way of making that, I don't know how to solve that problem, is what I'm saying. Do you have any suggestions?
I'll be completely honest and say I don't think that's an easy question. I suspect the issues around that question are very similar to the issues around data that could be released, and also FOI. So I think this is a lot. This issue is a lot broader than just specifically to applying to models. And if we can solve that more broadly, that would go towards addressing the issue around models. So I'm sorry, I can't do much better than that one.
Thank you for the talk, Audrey. One question I have to ask you about your open government model system relates to political neutrality. Political neutrality, because within the open source definition, there's a requirement that an open source license can't discriminate against potential users. So how could you build into that a requirement, which would deal with, for instance, in our political system where we have two parties who often have diametrically opposed opinions on certain issues? How would you recommend dealing with that? Thank you.
Can I get a clarification? Do you mean in terms of the usage of the model or the assumptions? Or are you talking about licensing issues around that?
I'm talking about the usage of the model.
Right. My view is that, from what I've seen, that the models themselves are dependent on assumptions. And so what we're doing is we tend to, and there are not many people in the public that actually contest the output of a model, but perhaps we should be questioning the assumptions of the model. And I think the assumptions is where those political philosophies would end up being reflected.
Hey, Audrey. Congratulations. That was a magnificent talk.
Thank you.
And everyone, I'm going to be telling to watch it. But just the question is about science versus government. So science tends to take its models and publish them for academic rigor and peer review and those kinds of things. Do you think there's an appetite for that approach in government?
Firstly, Pia, I'd love to say that I wish the scientific community would do more of that. My personal experience in academia has been that we tend to release a lot of our findings, but there has been some reluctance to release the source code that goes with it. In terms of releasing government models and having an appetite for that sort of openness. I think in some ways it's a public expectation because you're creating models on behalf of your community and the public. I would argue that academics working in the scientific community also serve as humanity, but perhaps they are a bit more progressive in that they're sort of looking at the future from a long-term perspective, so that, you know, we might have some pure mathematician come up with some really interesting theorem that would benefit humanity 50 years down the track. The issue with policy models is that it's very real and it affects our day-to-day lives. So I would argue that if there isn't that yearning for that, there should be, and perhaps it's about increasing the awareness around that.
We probably have time for one last question.
Thanks, Benno, and thanks, Audrey. Great talk. My question relates to the domestic versus the international. If you had a government open source model for Australia that's modelling Australian data and is an Australian model, is there a moral imperative for Australia to make that open for global benefit?
Very tricky one. I would argue that that situation would be no different to releasing open data. So a few months ago, I looked at open data from 5 different countries and compared their usability. I really think that there's a lot of scope for tapping into the international expertise. So we might release open data, and startups may create their own profits from that open data. But by releasing it, we're releasing it globally. So this dilemma, or rather this sort of issue of domestic versus international, I haven't fully thought out the implications of that. But certainly it would go towards government really thinking about what this would mean in terms of international policies. So tricky one. I'm not sure I can fully satisfy that question.
And please thank again Audrey Lobo-Pulo.
Thank you.